is Monday.
I have a digital copy of it on my website.
So, good afternoon, friends. I am Pramod. So, I'll be continuing the presentation given by Curtis. Since we had a long gap, let me give you a quick recap of what Curtis presented. So, we started with how evolution of social data, and we started with how Web 2.0 is different from Web 3.0, in that user-generated content started in Web 2.0, and whereas in Web 3.0, the network of the people and the connections between the people and various other elements like social context and became important, and how we are using a lot of semantic technologies like ontologies and all to get the clear information of the content. All this we talked in Web 3.0. And then next we moved on to social media. What are the various advantages of social media, and at the same time, what are various disadvantages? Advantages being you can get wisdom of crowd, and since people are using it ubiquitously, you'll get a lot of information from social media. And disadvantages being most of the text is informal and mediated, and there is a lot of slang involved in social media text. And at the same time, there are various limitations by social media applications like Twitter and all, which makes us to use only 140 characters, things like that. So now, today I will be talking about how semantics play a prominent role in solving some of these challenges. Let me get back. So before explaining how semantic web plays a role in this, let me ask you guys, what is the vision of semantic web? Most of you guys know, it is making web-based documents and data machine understandable, as well as easier to integrate and analyze upon. So this takes us to, okay, let me ask you guys a small question. What is the first step towards achieving this in any content? Any guesses?
Standardization.
I'm sorry, what?
Standards.
Yeah, standards. Which takes us to annotation, right? We annotate the content based on the most popular vocabularies and ontologies, so that it will be easier to integrate the content and analyze upon it. So that takes us to first step towards achieving semantic social web, that is marking up and annotating user-generated content. So having said that, what is the difference? Is there any difference between annotating a traditional content versus social media? So, of course, there is a difference. Social media is not as curated and as precise with all the grammar and all as traditional media. So there are a lot of challenges in annotating the social media. So, these are the following challenges. Curtis has already explained you these things, like the teen problem, which means that there is a lot of off-topic discussions, they are informal, and there is a lot of slang involved in that, and at the same time, the Twitter problem. So we need some mechanisms which are very prominent in semantic web to solve these problems. And when you talk about semantic web, the first thing that any semantic web guy talks about is ontologies, right? Ontologies and background knowledge. The reason behind that being, they act as a common reference models, and they play a significant role in inferring the semantics of the content. And we had a discussion, Dr. Sheth and all, in the last previous class, saying that it's not that only semantic web, we need to use only semantic web and there isn't anything like you should use only semantic web or NLP techniques. They should work hand in hand. So what we say is that semantic web plays a good role in supporting them. NLP techniques by which I mean is, by that what I mean is that they'll help them, they'll make it more economical and many other things. So I'll go step by step in which all ways semantic web plays an important role. The first thing is the dissemblic equation. So from this sentence that Lily, I loved your cherry tweeting to heart aiming. As a human being, what can we guess from that? We can say that Lily refers to some name, and again cherry tweeting refers to a name, which is a noun, and aiming. And if we have a little bit of domain knowledge about the music and all, we can say that Lily refers to Lily Allen, who is an artist, and Cheryl Tweedy is one of the track by that artist. And Amy Winehouse, who I think most of you guys know, she recently died of overdose. As a human being, I can say that Lily Allen and Amy Winehouse are not at all related. So here Amy doesn't refer to Amy Winehouse. But as a for a machine, is it possible to get that information through pure NLP based techniques? No, it is not. By NLP based techniques, we can identify that Lily refers to noun and Lily Allen. By some other sophisticated techniques, we can identify that Lily Allen is an artist, and at the same time, Cheryl Tweedy as a track by that artist. But we cannot identify that Amy is Amy Winehouse or just another name Amy. So how do we go about that? So we have this popular database, which is MusicBrainz. MusicBrainz is a free open source graph database which has all the information about artists, their tracks, and other information like the composers and many more. So we can use this background knowledge to clearly disambiguate between Amy and Amy Winehouse. So I will give you how we can use that. So if we go into the MusicBrainz Amy Winehouse page, there you'll have these tags. She's British, and she's death by overdose, and she's a her tracks are mostly jazz and blues. So we have this information of Amy Winehouse, and then we have the information about Lily Allen saying that he's also a British guy. And she's also British, and her tracks are mostly pop. So from this we can clearly say that okay, the genre of this artist Amy Winehouse is entirely different from the genre of Lily Allen. So we can identify that okay, the sentence that is being mentioned there, the Amy in that sentence is not Amy Winehouse actually. This way we can use semantic technology to disambiguate the nouns. And the second thing. So how can you clearly identify the entities? So even for me, if as a human being, if I don't have any domain knowledge of the music, Lil Smile Sorabs means that her smile is good. But if you have a good domain knowledge of the music, you'll say that the Smile is a track by Lily Allen, and again, it is good. So if you use just the syntactic parser, which passes the given phrase as whether the particular word is a noun or verb or anything, it says that smile is a verb and Lil is a noun. But it doesn't say any other information saying that Lily Allen's track is smile or anything like that. Again, if you go into the background knowledge, which is MusicBrainz, and look into the Lily Allen's page. You can clearly identify that Smile is a track by Lily Allen. So based on this knowledge that we are getting from the background, we can clearly identify the entities, saying that there in this sentence, Lyrics refers to Lily Allen, an artist, and again, Smile is a track, one of the track by this artist. So semantic web plays a good role in identifying the entities. Similarly, another example is Steve says all zooms and one case must go at prices permanently slashed. Here, Steve refers to Steve Ballmer, the Microsoft CEO, and all Junes and OneCares are the products of Microsoft. So to identify the correct entities in this sentence, we need the help of background knowledge. And the next thing is off-topic noise. So how many of you guys watched the video about Scroogling, the Microsoft video, where in which they say that, okay, my Google is getting all your content from Gmail and they are giving targeting advertisements on you based on your content, saying that they are reading all your emails. So this content analysis applications are becoming very popular now. So anyways, these companies, they need to make some money, right? In order for them to make some money, they need to advertise some products through which they will get the money. So let's say we collected waffle, and you guys know that the off-topic discussions are very common in any media. Let's say that we collected a phrase about Sony Vegas Pro. If you look into that phrase, I need help with Sony Vegas Pro, and I have a video project due tomorrow for Marilyn, and I need to do it simple. Blah blah blah. And again, this guy is talking about I got poisoning from eggs. It is not fun. So these three entities, which is Sony Vegas Pro, Merrill Lynch, and eggs, these three are entirely different entities. How can you, if I take a normal without any semantic technologies, if I take a normal content analysis application, okay, it will identify that Sony Vegas Pro and all these are nouns, and okay, there are some things related to eggs, Merrill Lynch, and Sony Vegas Pro. I'll throw advertisements based on these three. But how can you identify that these three are entirely unrelated? And most of you guys might have faced this, right? You don't want the unrelated advertisements to be posted on you, posted on your wall or anything. So how semantic web helps plays a role? Again, if you look into the background knowledge of Sony Vegas Pro, you can clearly say that these three are completely unrelated, and since we are collecting this whole phrase for that topic, we can just advertise that Sony Vegas Pro. This is the example given in the textbook. So here they are collecting the comments on the Illustrator, that is CS3, Adobe Illustrator CS3, and in that he has mentioned about masters and some other things. So the pure content analysis application just gave advertisements based on that masters and all. Whereas if you use semantic technologies, you'll find that those three are completely unrelated. And so, since my topic of interest is Adobe CS3, I should project only advertisement related to that. So in this way, semantic web plays role in removing the off-topic discussions. And this one is a very interesting application. So this one, this was a very classic example of how the NLP based techniques play an important role if they are combined with semantic technologies. I think most of you guys know of MySpace, right? Where in which every celebrity or an artist will have a page, and you'll post all the comments regarding that guy. So let's say we again, I don't know the reason behind you taking all the samples about Lily Allen. Maybe Dr. Chet like that post, I don't know.
That's Meena.
Yeah, Meena. Sorry. So here again, there is a phrase saying that smile by Lily Allen rocks. So using semantic technologies, we can identify that again smile is a track and Lily Allen is an artist. And using sentiment annotator, there are some phrases which give a positive words which tell that this sentence is positive, saying like rocks means this sentence is positive, or if there is any word saying sad or unhappy, things like that, it will say that okay, this sentence is negative. So once we identify that these tracks and the whole phrase is positive, we can say that we can, and like this, this is just a single comment. If there are like huge database of comments about an artist and all, we can say that this guy is going to be popular in the near future, because we have the data and we have the analysis saying that these many comments out of this data are positive regarding this guy. So this guy will be popular maybe tomorrow or something like that. So that was one.
For the sentiment analysis, which says rock is positive, you have a background knowledge, right? The static background knowledge for it.
It's not necessary that you have a background knowledge. There are, as of now, in this example that I'm saying, they have a set of phrases saying all these phrases come under positive sentiment. This is only binary classification.
Available for sentiments themselves.
The paper
that Lou just submitted, for example, is to create domain-specific sentiment lexicons, and in fact, particular phrases of the kind. So there's a lot of work in the area. That's how we do it. So, for example, you may create there are very specific terms. Let's say for entertainment. Let's say for music that convey sentiment that are not used for general conversations, and identifying them is another example. So that's a very unique and semantic approach to doing sentiment analysis.
So especially here, my idea is to just tell you how semantics can be used, combined with these sentiment annotator or things like that. I'm not portraying any application. So next thing is, how there are many apps which are built using this semantic web technologies, and which are becoming very popular by day. Which are becoming very popular day. So how many of you guys blog except for Dr. Shiv? The Sanjay, I know Sanjay blogs. There are a lot of people who blog. I think this might be a very interesting application for you guys. Have you ever heard of the application named Zemanta? So this application, it helps you to bring content. Like, let's say if you are writing a blog, the main thing that you will look into, like, while writing your blog, and if you mention some entity, let's say I'm talking about Apple iPad, you want some reference, like an Apple page to be linked to that word, so that users can directly go into that page and get more information of that. So, and previously how we used to do is that, okay, I have this entity, and what I used to do is go to Google search and search for all the pages, and I will select one of the best thing. So what this application does is that, as and when you write a sentence or a para or anything like that, and once you ask the application to give me all the content regarding this paragraph, it'll use Freebase to query for some. It will first identify the entities in that sentence or para that you are writing, and it will use the Freebase to query for that entity and give me all the related things to that entity. I will give you a small demo and then explain how they're actually doing it. I don't usually blog, so this is my first thing to show you guys that, you know, and thank you for it. Thanks for that. I need to press one button over here so that it will update. Let's say this is my blog, and if I'm writing, I don't know what is happening. I need to go this far because this is the presenter is not allowing me to go there. So once you update that, you'll get all the information related to Jane Austen, her novels and her birthplace, all the related information of that. And you can just drag that over here by, these are not the related information, but the information about this Jane Austen will come like this, and you can just click on that and it will directly add into your blog. So I'll tell you how that is being done. So how it is being done is that first it will identify all the entities using popular NLP techniques and all, and then once it identifies the entities and all, it will query Freebase. Here even these guys are using Freebase to get the information about that particular entity. And since if you see here, I typed that Jane Austen was a great English novelist. And once it queries the Freebase and it get the information like this book is Pride and Prejudice, which is a popular motion picture also adapted from this book. This was written by Jane Austen, and at the same time, the birthplace of Jane Austen. So once it gets this entities, it will query the relevant articles and all, and it will post there. So this is how Zemantha uses semantic technologies. And the next thing is the BBC Sound Index. Okay. I've been talking about how various semantic technologies are being used in various social media applications and all. So for any application or for any research to be used in a mainframe industrial thing, the first thing is that you need to get some business output, like some kind of profits or some kind of business insight from that research, right? So this is one effort being put to convert social intelligence to business intelligence. Here the BBC BBC Sound Index works is that, and one of our alumni, that is Meenakshi Nagarajan, she worked on this project. So how this works is that it will collect all the information regarding, let's say, a particular soundtrack or particular song, or it will collect all the information from various social media sources like YouTube, Flickr and all the sources, and it will analyze that information, and it will use semantic technologies, the one that I have mentioned before. It might use the sentiment annotator and the and the music brain's ontology to get the information about that artist or track, and then it will, based on all that information, it will give a near real-time aspect. So right now how this is being done is that once an artist releases an album or anything, after 1 month, or maybe I don't know what is the present scenario, but after 2 or 3 months, using it will appear in the billboard saying that these are the sales collections of this artist, these are this artist sold these many records. So based on that, you'll get to one conclusion that okay, it might be that this guy's song is very popular, so I need to buy the album. So what these guys try to do is that okay, I don't want to wait till 1 month or 2 months. I want like within two hours or 3 hours of what is being popular in the market. So as and when an artist posts a video in YouTube or various other social media applications, users will be commenting on that, on those tracks or on the songs or whatever. And these guys, they'll collect all the information and they'll analyze based on using music brains, the popular semantic ontology. And then they might use the sentiment annotator also to find the sentiment about that. And they'll, within 3 hours, they'll publish that, okay, these artists are very popular right now. So this can help the publishing companies like Sony and all to identify the artists and start the advertisement very fast, and at the same time it will help the artists. So here you can, it's not clear, but here you can see the next update will be in some 2 hours 15 minutes. So every 3 hours this chart will be updating. And this is the architecture diagram of how this is being done. They have all the unstructured data over here coming from various social media, and this is all the structured data. And they'll use the music brains and Urbana Dictionary. This Urban Dictionary, this is used to find the slang. Like various regions have their own slang, so Urbana Dictionary helps us to find the correct meaning of that slang. And using music brains as an annotator, they'll annotate the content and they'll publish the list of okay, these guys are popular in this 3 hours, in this time frame. So before going to the next application, how many of you guys know that Twitter caused Egypt revolution? Actually, you're right. Twitter didn't cause the Egypt revolution. Twitter helped in making that revolution very stronger. It helped in organizing the revolutionaries. And at the same time, it helped in getting a lot of support, a lot of international support, and the exposure to the revolution that is going on in Egypt. So there are various aspects of social media. It's not that as I have explained to you before, in Web 2.0, user-generated content became very important. People were able to publish, share, or whatever data that they have very easily. Whereas the next web, that is Web 3.0, we were able to get the information from the connections between different types of data, the connections between people, and it has been increasingly there is a lot of information. It's not only about how people are connected. People are not only connected through social tie, like he is a friend of this guy, and that guy is a friend of other guy. Not only that, people are connected through content. Like, okay, there is a tweet, and I'm able to retweet that, so that these two are connected based on the content. And analyzing these type of content with respect to time and where that content is gives you a lot of insight about that particular event. So one of the early efforts in using this type of information and building an application was Twitteris. This was our own application which was developed at Noises. So It's a 360 degrees social media analytic platform. It will analyze the data regarding various aspects, like let's say an event is occurring, and there are people in various regions have their own perspective of that event. Like let's say US in regarding the US elections, people in US they might have a different perspective, whereas people in India and all, they will have a different perspective about the US elections. So you need to identify these things, and at the same time, as the event evolves, as it moves further, the mindset of the people and how they are talking about the event changes. So that is the temporal aspect. Like tomorrow I will be talking about this event in a different way than I am talking right now. And so Pinterest captures all this information, and it will showcase this information in, so that you can clearly see it. So Pinterest is a tool that extracts social signals for sense making, which uses spatio-temporal thematic metadata extracted from observations to summarize the semantic content, and it will also create a mashups to visualize these aspects, so that you can clearly see what was going on, and you can also get all the related articles, information about that particular event. I'll give you a demo so that it will be very clear for you. So this event is about election 2012. I think we stopped. We stopped it on this date, that is 11th of 2012. So here you can see all the key phrases that are being mentioned about this event in this is mainly for US. If you click in one of these key phrases, you'll find all the relevant tweets and the articles that are used in these tweets, and all other information. And if you click in multimedia, you'll get all the images that are being used and videos about this event. This is all the information related to the event. And if you click on browse by location, it'll give the perception of people at various regions. Like let's say if you click on India, people in India are talking about US elections in the following. You can see how they are talking about US elections and all. So, okay, these two are the spatial and temporal aspects of Pinterest. And not only that, in this application, we are able to identify the sentiments of people. Like what is the sentiment towards US elections in US in a particular state? Let's say there is a competition between Obama and Romney. So how can you say that Obama, the sentiment towards Obama in this state is, what is the sentiment towards Obama in this state, towards Romney in this state? So in this application we are using a lot of sentiment analysis techniques, finding out the sentiment of all these tweets which are originating from a particular region. So you can better understand how the capabilities of Pinterest if you look into the insights of the insights. So I think most of you guys know that when are the election results declared, right? It's during November 6th, and fortunately we are in a state which is the deciding state for any presidential candidate, and it was decided at 11 p.m. on November 6th that Obama won the Ohio, and it was only after that news agencies declared that Obama is the winner, whereas Twitter has identified this like at 6 p.m. saying that from based on all the tweets that are originating from Ohio, we are clearly able to identify that Obama is going to win in Ohio. This is one very interesting application saying wherein which you can predict what will be going on. If you are very sophisticated enough, you can predict even 1 month before so that the presidential candidate, they can save a lot of money on campaigning and all. And this is the sentiment. So I think all of you guys know about as and when the first debate between Obama and Romney is over, and we all got to know that Romney is pounding on Obama, and Romney is very aggressive, right? And that one was clearly identified using the sentiment analysis part in this particular application. This is the next day after the first debate, where the sentiment towards Obama was less, whereas sentiment towards Romney is positive in the tweets coming. And again, another interesting application is the network analysis part. So this one more interesting thing that is being done in this application is the network analysis. How a network of people are connected. We are collecting all the user information for a particular event, who are tweeting, and we are analyzing their network, how they are connected and all. If you look into the debate again. After the first debate, Obama, all the followers or all the users who are saying positive about Obama, they became a bit sparse, saying that okay, this guy didn't perform well. Whereas if you look into the all the network of Romney, they are very positive, and they got again connected, and they started communicating with each other, saying okay, this guy is doing well. We need to give them a lot of support and things like that. So this is pretty much about the application, that is Twitteris. And next thing is, okay. So now we have a lot of tweets coming for a particular event, and the main problem. Let's say for you as an end user. Oh, I'm sorry, I forgot to mention. So I actually worked on this part of Twitteris. This is a very interesting part in Twitteris. So how can you answer some complex questions, like let's say the question over here: who are all the dead people mentioned in the context of OWS? Any guesses of how you can answer it? I will give you if you have the data set of all the tweets with you, and if you have let's suppose that you have all the NLP, all the best NLP techniques that are available with you, how can you answer a question like this: who are all the dead people mentioned in the context of OWS? Any vague guesses, like Occupy Wall Street. You have the data set of all the tweets collected for Occupy Wall Street, and you have all the softwares that are available on NLP techniques and all.
Okay. What are you trying to follow the people that are being talked about in the videos? This is what they said, names to search public records. You'll find destitutes.
So you'll do it for all the 1 million, 2 million tweets that you have with you?
Yes. Force it out. Take maybe 5 minutes, a couple multi-thread computers. You have a data set of names, mm-hmm. right, across the most tweets. You can farm that out to a couple servers, crunch the data through the OWS records, buy back in, wouldn't take that long.
Where are they going to get their...
Public records online.
Where?
They're online at any county courthouse.
And how do you access that?
We write a script to basically type the name in the search box, find the person's name, and what's that. Type together. You can, so like, you ever look for public records in county courthouses?
No, I understand, yeah. But I don't think that they are all available in the same format.
Yes, David. If they weren't, then you wouldn't be able to. They just have a list of people who are dead, besides somebody's name.
Is it online?
Usually, yeah. Most of us have someone.
And
how do you know where the people are from to look them up?
I don't know where the people are from. Yeah.
What, geotagging in the tweet?
Well, like, if the tweet just mentions a person.
A dead person.
Like a dead, yeah, the name of a dead person. How do you know where they're from to look them up? To know whether or not they're dead?
Yeah, I'm just guessing. Like, if you have a tweet, yeah, it'd be hard if you have a tweet for a person. I mean, it's not like it's impossible.
So let me explain you. Let me give you a walkthrough of how we did this using the background knowledge that is available online. So we have all the set of tweets. And what we did is that we used DBpedia, let's say here we use DBpedia Spotlight. What that does is that it will find all the DBpedia entities that are being mentioned in a tweet. Once we got that information, we formed a triple out of every tweet, saying that, okay, this tweet has, this tweet is tagged with this entity. Here, this entity is a DBpedia entity actually. And in DBpedia, you have all the information of, DBpedia is nothing but, Wikipedia, all the Wikipedia info boxes are taken and they are converted into triples and are stored in a RDF triple store. That has all the knowledge regarding whatever that is there in the Wikipedia. And you know that there is a lot of information that is there in the Wikipedia. So once we tag every tweet with the corresponding entity and all, we'll publish this. And we have the information saying that, let's say we have this information from DBpedia saying about Aristotle. Aristotle is one person, and that guy, he is of type person. And we have another information saying that Aristotle death places this thing, which means that he is dead in some place. And we have information about every person in all important persons in the world. And combining these two, once we tag the tweet with the entities and the information that is available in the background, there is a query language for all this kind of triples, saying that, okay, the query language is called Sparkle query language. It's more of like a graph matching, pattern matching. So you, in this language, you'll say that you'll give an abstract way how a triple will be. And this will match for every triple that is there in the RDF store. Okay, here you will mention that, say, give me all the tweets which are tagged with person, and that person is of type ontology person, and that person's death place is United States. So we have this information from DBpedia and this information from tweet. So once we fire a query like this, it will give me all the dead people that are being mentioned in these tweets from a particular region, let's say United States, or any region that you want.
So the query that you said,
I
list all of the dead people, mm-hmm. that I mentioned in that, yeah. Didn't say that, what if somebody who is not a person and is not listed in Wiki, that you don't have to data.
This is only for the important people that are being mentioned in the context of crimes.
Well, that changes it completely then. You said all the people, so I was like, search county records.
That confused.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Yeah, I think I need to rephrase it.
Yeah, that made it a lot different.
Alright. Yeah, so, you're explaining the search and the explore tab, right? So, is this query generated and created dynamically based on what I enter in the search text box?
Right now, we have a fixed set of queries that we think which are very popular and which will be very helpful for the people who are looking into the application. We can even generate, we can write a front end saying that enter these things and we can automatically formulate a query and fire it on the network.
So how about any person name, right? If
they occurs
with the recipe,
then
in that person?
Any person occurring with?
So any name, right?
We are very clear that if this guy, if the ontology says that the death place is genital stress, that guy is a dead person. So that is the reason we are firing queries like this. If we know that the information saying that if that guy is tagged with some rest in peace or anything, and that means that that guy is dead, we can fire a query in that way. So we need to know how the triples are being stored in the DBpedia, and then based on that, we need to formulate a query and query.
I have a question. Are you assuming that all the triples are correct? Like that they just got parsed like perfectly?
Yeah, okay. We are assuming that. Because the DBpedia is a community-driven thing, and it was according to the standards of by W3C. So, having explained about that, we have all this DBpedia information regarding most. It has around 20 some I think 3.4 million things and all from all around the world. And we have this tweets coming for a particular event. Let's say I'm looking for as a journalist or something. I want all the tweets that are being mentioned about a particular event. And normally, how we do that in the Twitter right now is that we'll go to search and search thing and we'll type the hashtags, because hashtags is the predominant way of aggregating tweets. And once you type that, you'll get all the tweets, and you need to again go through each and every. Tweet, because first thing is that hashtags are not well organized, meaning that there isn't any particular company or anything saying that okay, you need to use this hashtag only for this purpose. It is, they are majorly generated by the users. So you won't get correct set of tweets that you want actually. So that is the problem regarding Twitter tweets and all. And on the other hand, we have semantic technologies. Like we have the DBpedia and we have a rich query language, which is Sparkle, to query upon like this particular subset. I want, based on my query, I want this particular subset of triples or something. So how can we combine these two? On one hand, we have tweets and all. And on the other hand, we have the RDF store, which was standard information, which is correct, which is assumed to be correct. So Twitter is an infrastructure to merge these two. So it will translate the microblog posts from Twitter into linked open data in real time. So as and when the tweet comes, it will annotate the tweet with all the entities using common vocabularies like, let's say, friend of a friend ontologies or MOAT. Using all these ontologies, it will annotate the tweet and it will publish that set of triples into the RDF store. So we can using the linked open data, the background knowledge of DBpedia, and the information that we are getting about this tweet, we can filter that, okay, this tweet has this information which is very relevant to me, and so give me this, you can subscribe to that tweet. I will tell you how this is being done. So as and when the tweet arrives from a Twitter streaming API, you will annotate the tweet with all the information, like all the entities and hashtags that are being and URLs that are being mentioned to the tweet. using the shared vocabularies like FOFS, SIOC, and MOIT. Once you are done with that, and with all the information from DBpedia, you'll store all the triples that are coming for this tweet and all the information from DBpedia into a common triple store and provide the user with the Sparkle endpoint. Okay, now I have all the information, you can query using Sparkle. Once that is done, the users, like the end customer, they can subscribe to this particular application, saying that okay, I need all the in this example, this guy, he needs all the information, all the tweets which are related to healthcare in Ohio. So we have we annotated the tweet with all this information using the common vocabularies, and this was coming from DBpedia. Okay, this entity that is being mentioned in the tweet has some relation to DBpedia Healthcare, and at the same time, the user who is tweeting this is from a location which is DBpedia Ohio. So you'll formulate this kind of concept feeds, and you'll put that into these. So you'll put those concept feeds over here. So as and when the tweet arrives and is annotated and all, this will be evaluated based on this concept feed. And if it agrees with that concept feed, that will be pushed to you. So this is the total Sparkle architecture. Once the tweet arrives, it will be converted using all the tech. It will be annotated against the common vocabularies and the ontologies that are being there, and you will provide a Sparkle endpoint for that, and the users can just subscribe to one of the concept feeds over here. And as it is like, instead of pulling all the data as and when the tweet arrives, it will push to the concerned user. So this is an interesting application that is Sparkle, and that ends our presentation. So the conclusion being that now we have lot of social media, we need to somehow find a way to integrate all the content that is coming from social media, so that you can once you search for any term or anything, it will get all the content from the social media. And our final goal is to link all the data that is being there in the world. And that brings us to the conclusion, saying that there is a great potential in integration of social web and semantic web, where objects are treated as first-class citizens, making it easier to search, integrate, and exploit the information surrounding them. Thank you.
Okay. So, questions? Let's see, what did you get? Comments? Questions?
I have a comment on
yes,
the presentation.
Yes, yes.
That was a really sweet presentation.
Yeah, it was.
Where did you
make
it to?
It's not a template, it's a software. Presentation software.
But when you start one, it's like really like sparse. Like you did a lot of work. That was.
Yeah, everybody's awake. Alright, so comments, guys? What did you get? What's the takeaway? Ishita?
That semantic web helps in disambiguating a lot of stuff, like when you're talking in terms of a topic. It allows you to disambiguate only in concern to what you want. Like for Twitterers, if they're talking, not Twitterers, like in any post, if somebody is talking off topic things, but you're only interested in some particular thing, semantic web helps in that. And he was was talking like.
So what was the example?
The ads on the Google,
okay.
Gmail, whatever ads we get.
Mm-hmm. That was Facebook, yeah.
No, the Google ads where Photoshop that thing.
Some
like,
advertisements related to a particular topic.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah. So
those were the posts, and that was the application done on Facebook, though.
Yeah.
It was Facebook.
Oh, the ads may be from Google.
Yeah, ads from Google.
The posts were Facebook posts.
Okay. That was one thing. What
you
told me.
So, did you, okay, who would want to explain the example of Smile and how did that work? Just to get a. Let's see. What
I think, based on what Nishita said, I do have a question. It seemed like. When you're talking about advertisements, it's more of NLP point of view, because you're trying to extract something from the text. So if you're trying to do something similar to entity identification, you need to understand the NLP problems. It's not a semantic web problem, but it's an NLP problem, is what I think it is.
So is it a semantic web problem, a semantic problem, or an NLP problem?
I guess it's both, because, you have identified the entities that is really challenging and that is actually a problem.
What does identification of entity mean?
Identification of entity, it means that if you have a sentence or a block, any of the text, in that you have a bunch of words, which word represent to a entity, what we can call it as a person, place, or...
How do you know that it's... a personal place or identities or an organization.
Yeah, exactly. So for that identification of entity, I mean, there are some NLP techniques that it's the first letter. If the first letter is in caps, then it can be a
that
person.
Is, I would not call it NLP, that is just lexical.
Yeah, so and NLP, it's like, if you have whole sentence and if your that entity or say a noun, verb, and the sentence is structurized in that way, by that you can actually identify that, okay, this...
What is that process called?
Parsing.
And then what do you do?
So we identify the, as you said, we identify the nouns, pronouns, or something like that from the sentence, and then we use a knowledge base like DDPedia to identify if those actually mean, if they are already there in the DDP in our knowledge base to identify them as a...
First of all, you do the parsing and then you can do parts of each tag. Right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
So that's an important step.
Yeah.
And that
so
typically
the
is considered
what you said
to be
is actually
of
right?
Yeah.
Now, having done that much, how would you know what it means without any semantics?
Right, I think you also need to consider the context in which things are used.
The context is useful to get that particular...
To disambiguate,
right? Sure. But even before you disambiguate, to get the fact that indeed SAP is the name of a company versus a sap of a tree. Very different, right? So if you all you have is NLP, but you don't have any background knowledge like DBpedia,
right.
How are you going to get it?
Okay.
So I think if the sentence is structurized in a perfect way, then we can actually get that this is an organization.
How? Give me an example of a sentence and tell me that what you will find is actually for sure an organization and not just some noun.
Yeah, so actually I don't know the exact technique to do that, but I have used the Stanford parser, which was actually...
How would Stanford parser tell you that there's actually an organization in the real world?
Yeah, so I didn't read the technique in whole great detail, but from the results what I got from that parser was just that some kind of lexical thing they were using. But again, I consider that the challenge in social media, if you don't have the perfect sentence, then it will not help.
Even if you have a perfect sentence, and even if you, you know, what will the Stanford parser give? Will the Stanford parser give me the fact that this is actually a technology, a company?
Will it give you the fact that it is a technology company? Will it give you the fact that it is a technology company with this product?
Yeah, so it will not give me that level of specialized information, but it would identify that, okay, this might be the organization, this might be the person.
Now this is your homework. In the next class, you come and discuss, explain to us how much of Central Parcel will tell you about finding an organization,
yeah,
a name of a person, so and all the stuff.
So in this case, semantic web is just providing you background knowledge, in a way.
Is that true? Is that true? Is it just giving you background knowledge? It's actually not providing, it is using background knowledge.
Sure.
Okay, what? Is that all?
No, for us to be able to consume that background knowledge, we need semantic. We need RDF and algorithm. So we need semantic technology to consume that.
Forget about the technology part of it. There's a lot more though about semantics and semantic web and semantic techniques that you're getting. You understand the process. You have a sentence, parse it, you find different parts of the sentences. So the tagging would mean give you this PP and JJ and all this stuff, right? That's what it would be, right? Then what? After that, what do you do with it? After that, how do you understand something that is meaningful to the human research? If I have two sentences, one sentence says palm oil, and another has palm OS, and even the third one, let's say, has a palm as in PDA. These are the three different entities. How well each of them will be recognized? To what level it can be recognized on its own with your lexical and NLP techniques? How much would the software, computer software, understand what those terms are? Palm oil, palm OS, and palm PDA. How well can they understand and distinguish between the three? To what level it can say, I found three different things. Can it say that? First of all, not just palm, but it's palm oil, palm PDA, palm something. Right? And then, having found that, to actually distinguish what how a human brain or how a human would distinguish between these three terms. Where do you make that jump? What is it that software needs to make that jump so that the understanding is similar to somewhere close to that then there is meaning to it. Right? There's a whole lot of more meaning when I say palm PD versus palm OS. And it is not even the words palm PDA or palm OS. It is that, PDA is personal digital assistant. That it can do this kind of stuff. It can give me all the context, right? It is OS. So there are the following OS in the market. This is one of those four major OS in the market. These are all things typically necessary and available to you free when you, as a human, just come across those words, those terms, you pick that up and you associate with all the knowledge. And there are several things that are happening. One, just as a starting point, is that background knowledge. That somewhere on DBpedia or somewhere in dictionary or somewhere in database, it has been said that there are all these different ways in which palm can be used. So you will say that, this palm oil, and by the way, if there is some other word set of terms that are used where oil is not explicitly, or what does it say? What if it says palm personal digital assistant spelled out versus palm PDA? It's the same, your human brain will say this is the same thing. What would it take for you to write a program or for your program or your search engine to actually understand this is the same thing? Starting from identification of palm, identification of personal digital assistant, making sure that these four words are actually captured into one phrase and mapped to palm PDA and say and understand these two are actually equivalent. What does it take? Having done that,
to recognize that it is a PDA and there is a meaning to PDA, it has certain functionality, what does it take? Is it are you getting it from background knowledge? Are you getting it from background knowledge in the sense that you actually are traversing the now knowledge base, ontology, which where there may be a domain model that models PDA and its functions, and hence you understand that. You see, there is a PAM PDA by itself is simply still some syntax. Having mapped to actual entity in the knowledge base, now you have certain level of semantics, but not complete. Then, assuming that in the ontology, a PDA is modeled with functional, you know, the functionality of that, there is some level of modeling of that. So, some level of knowledge that is added, understanding that is added. Because I would say PDA has these properties. And I would say the PDA also runs a particular operating system. And I would say that operating system of a PDA and the PDA as a device are related. That if is already modeled in ontology, then there is existing semantics that is modeled, which is leveraged to make to understand this text. So it's not just the reference. So the first and foremost point is to use the background knowledge base or ontology as a reference, as a thing where they have all these entities and there's a agreed upon meaning of that entities, those entities. Okay? Then comes this entire model around that that is available to you. Let me take back take you to the discussion that I had given last time when we were discussing our ontology, where we said, oh, this is a time instance. I model, you know, and I have time instance that is modeled in my ontology as a concept. But then I would have potentially in the time ontology the ability to define before time, after time. Right? Tell me if there is any lexical processing that could give you that.
Well, it would definitely improve the efficiency.
Would you get somehow how easy or hard it would be for you to do NLP to understand that there are concepts like before time and after time and near time on its own without the modeling? What you have to do is to write rules, right? But when the rules are written, would there be consistent interpretation of those rules across the people? Or the rules are used simply to understand that there is a part of species here, that there is a particular entity here. There's a lot more. It's not just that it is a computation before time, after time. It's a form of computation. And that is not typically formally defined. If all you're trying to do is understand the text by itself. So what happens is that we have to take the text as a vehicle of semantics, as something that conveys to us something, and then use the knowledge base as much as is captured. Ultimately, that ontology came by human involvement. Somebody developed the schema, somebody gave the constraint, somebody defined before and after functions. And having done that, and having done it in a formal language, then I can consistently use it for understanding a whole bunch of stuff. I can use that ontology to understand text. I can use that ontology to understand XML document, semi-structured document. And I can use that ontology to understand structured document, even a database, as an example. Suppose I was given a relational database, a table, and it had these concepts of time 0, 4, 45 and time PM and time 0, 4, 46 PM. Then it would be that modeling in the ontology that can help me understand that this time is before that time. How would you know the arithmetic operator is meaningful in this case? And in what way it is meaningful? Right?
Yes.
I think I missed one part, like establishing a relationship between entity and the knowledge base. I mean, how are we establishing a relationship between entity and knowledge base? As you said, that palm is palm or palm tree or palm OS. How it will establish a, like, these things are separate. What are we looking for? How does this make sense?
Very good question.
And one question.
There's a lot more to it, yes.
Yeah, actually, I just want to know who populates the data, knowledge base, whether it's us or it's come with ready-made all information.
Well, the knowledge base or ontology, there are multiple ways that they are being developed. Right? So, ontologies traditionally are developed by humans,
mm-hmm.
an expert. So, there will be somebody like Sujan,
mm-hmm.
who knows the language in which we formally write the ontology. So, let's say our language. Okay. And then, he has developed an ontology on cardiology.
Mm-hmm.
But he's not a cardiologist, and he does not deal with cardiology day in, day out.
Mm-hmm.
He doesn't know a lot of knowledge about the cardiology. So, he gets guidance from what he consults somebody who does cardiology related work day in and day out.
Mm-hmm.
That is one method.
Mm-hmm.
So, he works with a gentleman named Suhas Nair,
mm-hmm.
who deals with cardiology data and encoding of electronic medical record for cardiology patients,
mm-hmm.
and has been doing so for years and has gained a lot of knowledge. Okay? So he can consult and get additional information. One form of ontology building is pure manual,
mm-hmm.
and it can take years. So you probably have met and seen Christopher Thomas.
Mm-hmm.
Earlier, before that, there was another student of mine called Satya Sahu. Christopher Thomas developed an ontology for complex carbohydrate. It's an ontology for glycan expressions. These are, you know, the organic molecules, large molecules. And he sat down next to biochemist, who is a domain expert, for 2 years and asked all the questions, and he will model the things, and that guy will say, okay, look at the, you know, this information and model it, and then the expert will look at it and approve. Sometimes it is one expert or two experts that you consult and you develop an ontology. And that guy's authority. So it is the authority of that person that is vested by this process of creating a formal model.
Mm-hmm.
An analogy of that is something called, is an old discipline called knowledge engineering. So in 1988, I remember,
mm-hmm.
I was asked to do a project for writing an expert system of the chrome plating process of the landing gear of military aircraft. You know, so record it, right? Chrome plating, nickel cadmium plating. So either, you know, it was nickel cadmium plating, nickel plating rather, of landing gear. Landing gear, you'll see shiny thing around that. That process is extremely finicky. And it has to be done in the right way, right temperature, right material, all kinds of stuff, right? And so, what process to be followed? And that whole thing was encoded as rules and there was a very popular AI subdiscipline called expert systems. So the idea was there was an expert system built for medical disease diagnosis. Very well known expert system in 80s. Now, the same thing being done today with IBM Watson in a totally different way. By and large, people agree, I'm going now off the on the side, but I'll come back to your question and answer that. By and large, it is really, people are not using the expert system, and it is, many people believe that it has generally failed to scale. It's still a nice, you know, theory, and I mean, it was a nice practice and nice activity, and in some cases it was useful, but the applications were limited, and the broad scalability, applicability of large number of things, scaling it, all that was has not been considered to be a successful thing. In fact, it became an important showpiece of what is called as AI winter, meaning
In 1980s, the AI got extremely, AI will replace human, we'll understand the human brain. All kinds of major things were done, just like robots will take over all the humans. That's being said today now. Same way those days, we will say that, all the human thinking can be replaced by, engineering the human knowledge, putting into expert systems, and these programs will replace human. And it became an important showcase of the failure, and that is called as AI winter. So for 10 and 20 years, people considered AI to be a failed discipline. Now AI is suddenly back in vogue. Now AI is hot again. Okay, we'll talk about it some other time. But the principle was that I take human knowledge, encode into rules. The ontology is about the same. One form of ontology development, which is manual, is to take human knowledge, ask the human experts, and model into this language. And you've seen our language, right? The second approach is to do it semi-automatically. And in that, what may happen is that you kind of design the classes and relationship types, but then you go to very high quality knowledge base or database or sort of where you know that the facts are correct, and you map that to populate the ontology. So the schema is done manually, and the knowledge base or facts part of the population. So you, what you call is a description of the domain and the facts of the domain. So there are many different words that are used. One also called extension and intention. Intention and extension. Right? Schema is intention, and the facts are extensions. So these are the same kind of, they are the same meaning more or less. So you remember the architecture of the search engine Tali Woket, where we had knowledge crawlers or knowledge agent going to knowledge, external databases, getting the facts and populating ontologies. So we use that particular approach, where the schema was manually designed using tool like Protégé, and some of you may have exposure to that, and the database was populated by looking at the knowledge base. Then there's further refinement. So for example, Sujana has developed a technique whereby it goes through EMR, electronic medical records. In the ontology, you have concept of symptom and disease, right? And there is a relation between symptom and disease, right? That this particular symptom is expressed in the context of this disease. What is the specific relationship you use?
To put it in simple terms, is symptom of.
Is a symptom of, right? So that is the relationship that you're trying to populate in the ontology. So he developed a technique whereby now it analyzes the electronic medical record, which is unstructured data, and gives you candidate instances of these relationships that can be added to the ontology. So this is called semi-automatic ontology enrichment, right? Where it is not totally automatic. It gives you all the candidates, and then human expert says, yes, I agree with that. No, I don't agree with these things, as an example, right? So this is semi-automatic. So again, not all manual. So it does not take 2, 3, 4 years to build it. We are able to build it in like a matter of months, right? Or order of magnitude improvement with this kind of techniques. And then comes totally automated techniques, but the automated techniques can't develop what we typically call of as ontology. It can create a nice domain model. And so the work by Christopher Thomas, who recently graduated, he got his PhD in December, some of you might have attended his talk. His work was to automatically mine Wikipedia to create the domain model. Right? Okay. Now coming back to your question. The question was about associating a concept found in a text or data to a concept that is modeled in the ontology. Right? So basically it is an expression of a link. And general issue there is that you have data and you have ontology, your conceptual model. And you're going from the fact that you are linking that name of a person, name of a disease, to something described in the ontology means that you are giving a definitive
reference to this thing, which may mean whatever, to something that is formally defined in the ontology, which is then much better understood by programs. Right? And that can be done by many different ways. So, in the sensor data context, we use the syntax called XLink. Right? It's just one of the ways where you link to concepts using XLink, right? In the semantic web services, particularly SA-REST that we had discussed earlier, we described that using a construct, language construct called model reference. And we called it lifting. Lifting in the sense that you have a data level concept, we are lifting it to a model or conceptual or ontological concept. And lowering will be to mapping it back to another data level concept. Right? Now, what we are doing here is that we are taking some concept, it's in isolation, in the text, let's say. Right? The name of a person, name of a company. I take a name of a company, Cisco Systems. It says Cisco, that's it says, right, in the text. I X-link it or model reference it or different other ways I can say, reference it to the ontological concept of a company called Cisco Systems. There are two, by the way, Cisco Systems with two different spellings, right? So, having mapped exactly the Cisco Systems as in the networking company, then allows me to use all the concepts around that I made in the ontology. The concepts may be that Cisco Systems is a company, it's a part of technology companies, is a company. A company, and then every company, a company is a public company or a private company, is a S corporation, C partnership, or a C corporation, right? And that if it is a C corporation and public company, it has to have this particular minimum, let's say, a number of executives. It has to have CFO, it has to have CEO, something along that line. Typically, they would have CIO and so on and so forth, CTO. If it's a technology company, it would have CTO or something along that line. So all that will come about. And if my ontology, which has these models of company and company executives, and the corresponding knowledge base, in the case of Cisco Inc. and John Chambers, the CEO of Cisco Inc., all that becomes available to me. Now in the text, I come Cisco and I see the word John Chambers or Mr. Chambers. Now it is quite possible that I can use that knowledge base to make a sense of what that Chambers is. Suddenly I might even conjecture that that Chambers is not a chamber, air chamber or anything like that. That chamber is Mr. Chambers. Or I look at part of speech tagging, which tells me the kind of entity it is. So it will probably tell me it's a demo, potentially demo person. And I know that co-located to Cisco is one Mr. John Chambers. I might even use statistics that Cisco and John Chambers appear very often in the database. That is statistical. So I can combine statistical cues, knowledge base or ontological cues, all that to improve my understanding. Did I answer your question? Okay, well, I think we'll take a break here. It's because it's 5 o'clock, but we can continue. We'll let you know. Thank you.